Right, good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. David Canton, the director of the African American Studies Program at the University of Florida, and welcome to our golden anniversary celebration of Black Thursday. Think about it, exactly 50 years ago today, Black students at the University of Florida went into President O'Connell's office and presented six demands. Our keynote speaker, Dr. Stewart-Fullwood, will provide her firsthand account of the event because she was here at UF when Black Thursday occurred. So before we get to our keynote, we have a number of other speakers on the roster, and let's not wait, let's get this moving. Before we begin, I'd like to send a shout out to our sponsors, the African American Studies Program, the Gator Chapter of the NAACP, and the organization Sistuhs have put this together. And before we start, we will hear the singing of the Black National Anthem by Kristen Anderson.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days that hope unborn had died, yet with a steady beat have not our weary feet come to the place for which our fathers died. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the gloomy past till we now stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on our way, thou who hast by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places, O God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand. stand, true to our God, true to our native land.
Well done. Thank you, Ms. Anderson. Next, we have Stanley Richardson, American poet, actor, playwright, social political commenter, and lecturer. The inaugural Poet Laureate of Alachua County, Florida, 2020 to 2022. He is the author of the award-winning book of poetry, Hip Hop is Dead, Long Live Hip Hop, The Birth, Death, and Resurrection of Hip Hop Activism.
Unmute myself. Greetings, good evening, and thank you, Dr. Canton and the African-American Studies Program at the University of Florida for inviting me to take part in this commemorative occasion. Normally, I wouldn't give a little background on a poem. I would just give you the poem and it becomes yours and you do with it what you will, but this time I'll give you a little bit of what went into the crafting of this poem. When I started doing research, when you ask me to craft something, compose something, I started doing research. And one name I kept running across kept coming up with interviews and YouTube, and that was Dr. Betty Stewart-Fullwood. So I reached out to her, tracked her down via social media and found her inbox, and I asked her to, if she would help me, assist me to, by providing me a list of words that would give me the essence of what was going on back 50 years ago on that spring day in April. Her words were so powerful, I decided to make her correspondence to me part of this poem. So the poem is Golden. The beginning of the poem is Dr. Betty Stewart-Fullwood's response to my request. Once again, the poem is Golden. Here is a list of words that I believe capture the feelings, emotions, and the spirit of the events leading up to Black Thursday at the University of Florida in the spring of 1971. Hopefully, this will assist you in penning your poem commemorating this event. I didn't realize that I had so many emotions. Defiant, empowered, angry, mad, disappointed, betrayed, uncertain, upset, confused, tired, challenged, invisible, inspired, taken for granted, unappreciated, marginalized, satisfied, frustrated, anxious, determined, motivated, focused, centered, powerful, encouraged, strengthened, strong, proud, relieved, hopeful, optimistic, golden. Tilted is our cup, how agency flows bottom up makes it difficult to measure our victories and our displeasure. Eternal, a feather free falls from heaven into the abyss. A silken thread floats mercurial on Babylon's breath. An old spiral cylinder turns slowly, resting inside systemic by another name, another idea, another idea. Inclusion, diversity, equity, access, illusion. In Florida, just like in Alabama, I can hear Coltrane's horn blow. Disenfranchisement, blow. Nonviolent resistance, blow. An elegant rage, a beautiful struggle, an exquisite expression of discontent. Our time spent singing the same golden spiritual. The more things change, the more things change, the more things change, the more they remain the same. Back again. Is this the refrain, the hook to our never-ending song, our war cry, our oh Lord, why, our do or die, our wilderness to wander? Yes, the hill we climb, only to find ourselves once again, generations at the foot, like Sisyphus, perpetually pushing in perpetuity, our rock, golden. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Richardson. Great poem, get you thinking, really setting this context. And so as you know, I'm a historian, trained historian. I think I want to provide a few minutes to really set the context, right? What was it like April 15th, 1971? Think about it, 50 years ago. This day, 50 years ago, Marvin Gaye's What's Going On was the number one R&B song, political track. The front cover of the April 1971 Ebony magazine was Bill Cosby, who was featured in a movie titled Man and Boy, about an ex-Civil War soldier who had moved to Arizona to start a new life with his family. In 1971, former heavyweight champ Muhammad Ali was released from prison for refusing to go to Vietnam, and later that year lost to Joe Frazier in a heavyweight championship fight in Madison Square Garden. In 1971, Angela Davis, scholar and activist, was on the front cover of Time magazine, and Dr. Jeanetta Cole, Jacksonville native, professor of anthropology, had published Black Women in America, an annotated bibliography on Black women's scholarship in the journal Black Scholar, which was a brand new journal founded in 1969. Locally, in 1971, there were 3 Black faculty and 387 Black students at the University of Florida. In Richard Rothstein's The Color of Law, A Forgotten History of How Our Government Segregate America examines how the federal government sustains segregation by not punishing segregation. He examines the role of the Internal Revenue Service. According to Rothstein, the IRS has always had an obligation to withhold tax favoritism from discriminatory organization, but it almost never acted to do so. When UF and other universities prohibited Black students from admissions, the IRS should have withheld tax-exempt status when the promotion of segregation by nonprofit institutions was blatant, explicit, and influential. On November 5th, 1968, Black students at San Francisco State University went to President Robert Smith's office and presented a list of 10 demands. This was the beginning of Black students' protests across the countries at universities. William Chafe's Civilities and Civil Rights, Greensboro, North Carolina, and the Black Struggle for Freedom analyzes the role of civility in Southern politics between 1958 and 1971. During the Civil Rights era, white Southern university presidents used civility as a tactic to delegitimize the students' protests and demands. Chafe notes, as victims of civility, Blacks had long been forced to operate within an etiquette of race relationships that offered almost no room for collective self-assertion and independence. White people dictated the ground rules and the benefits when only to those who played the game. But this all changed on April 15, 1971. The Black students who participated in the protests were socialized in churches, schools, pool halls, and corner gatherings where, according to Chafee, another culture existed, one of assertion rather than deference. Fabio Rojas from Black Power to Black Studies how radical social movement became an academic discipline. Between 1966 and 1973, Black studies was a pressing issue on college campuses as a direct result of the civil rights movement, a rise in national sentiment, and student mobilization. Students formed Black student unions that carried out strikes, protests, and riots at dozens, possibly hundreds of campuses. According to Jeffrey Akbar, in Black Power, Radical Politics and African-American Identity, he's commenting on Black student protests. He contends Black students by 1968 were developing defiant methods that represented the new Black mood. Without concern of formality and deference to authority, Black students typically saw their efforts in the broader context of resistance to racist domination in the era of Black power. By 1973, over 1,200 colleges and universities had 5,611 courses in Black studies, including UF. UF had a certificate program in 1971, where students were required to take 6 courses, 4 required courses, such as African History to 1800, and 2 electives, such as History of Jazz or Ethnic Literature. In 2021, this day is the golden anniversary. This year is the golden anniversary of the first student receiving a certificate in African American Studies. Now, before you ask, we have tried to locate the student's name, but was unable to find it. However, half a century later, through Black students, faculty, staff, community struggle, UF is finally on its way to developing an African American Studies department. So again, the context, 50 years. Now, how can you have an event on Black Thursday without students? Makes no sense. So our next two speakers are active students on campus. Again, that tradition of student activism being engaged. They will share a few words about today's event. First, we have Ms. Sarah Louis, president of the NAACP Gator chapter of the NAACP Junior African American Studies Poli-Sci double major.
Thank you so much, Dr. Canton. Thank you so much, Mr. Richardson, for your wonderful words. And Dr. Betty Stewart-Fullwood, it's such an honor to be in the same space with you virtually. So hi, everyone. My name is Sarah Louis. In terms of the golden anniversary of Black Thursday, thinking of golden, I think of Jill Scott's Golden, her song, where she talks about taking her freedom, putting it on a shelf. I'm not going to sing the song because I can't sing. But in thinking of this golden anniversary, I think of that song. Black Thursday was about Black students using their agency and their power to reclaim a sense of their freedom, to reclaim a sense of their power. And I also think of civil rights activist Fannie Lou Hamer. She said, I quote, "I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired." 50 years later, there are still demands that were made on April 15th, 1971 that have not been fully met. And I'm sick of tired of being sick and tired. I'm sick of this historical legacy, this collective conscious that those Black students who came before me, Black people who came before me, my ancestors, that we still have to bear today. Although this is a celebration, we have to think about the work that has to continue to be done. Dr. Canton set this up so well in talking about Black Thursday in the historical context. I think of Ibram Kendi, a wonderful scholar, in his book, Black Campus Movement, about when he discusses how Black Thursday essentially at UF comes from that period of the 1960s, post-civil rights movement, the beginning of the Black Power movement, after the death of Malcolm X, that time of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, that time and where students are feeling that power. We have to come together, we have to demand the things that we want because we deserve it. And so when I think of Black Thursday and I think of where we are now in 2021, a lot of students, at least in my experience, don't know the power of how radical Black Thursday truly was, that history, if you want to call it radical. The Institute of Black Culture, the IBC, the Black Enrichment Center, the BEC, the Black Student Union, the African American Studies Program on campus, they all come from this history that I would consider radical. And why is it radical? Because Black people who have been oppressed in this country for so long, Black students, Black faculty banded together, stood in solidarity and said, this is what we want. And when the university didn't give it to them, over 100 students withdrew. And to me, that's powerful. To be here with you all today, talking about this legacy is powerful, this radical history. And my connections to Black Thursday stem from the Samuel Proctor Oral History Program, wonderful resource on campus to learn about the oral histories of that time. They stem from being a member of the Black Student Union, a general body member. And what I think is really powerful in thinking about where we are today as a student, it's about that connection to faculty. I would not be here as a student and being as successful as I am without the leadership of Dr. Canton, who just came to the university less than a year ago, but without my connections to Dr. Carl Simeon, who's over the Institute of Black Culture and BEC and Black Affairs, without the wonderful Dr. Patricia Hilliard Nunn, who passed away recently and who left such a big legacy on this campus. In thinking about Black Thursday and thinking about where we need to go going forward, I think it's important for students to continue maintaining relationships with faculty and staff, and also with one another, and standing in solidarity. And just to leave you all with some food for thought, continue as students and continue as faculty and staff to support one another, to understand our history, to understand where we are. And I know Dr. Betty Stewart-Fullwood will continue to talk about Black Thursday, but it's really important to reflect on where we are today and where we want the university going forward. I know UF has put out an anti-racism coalition, and Dr. Sharon Austin and Dr. Canton are working on different racial justice grants as we speak, but there's more work to be done. We still have to press the University of Florida to address the issues such as supporting prison slavery through the Food Justice Coalition. You know, we have to continue pushing the university to be better. It's such an honor to be here with you all today, and I'm gonna pass it back to Dr. Canton, so thank you.
Thank you, young but yet so wise. I appreciate those words, very inspiring. You know, it's like I wanna get a t-shirt, you know, to say my kids are better and smarter than I am. You know, that's why I love to see that enthusiasm, so that's great. Next up, we have Smita Cornell, president of Sistuhs, a senior. Congratulations, shout out. She's graduating this semester, majoring in sociology and family, youth, community. I forgot the last one. Family, youth, community, service, community. I messed that science. Up. Say that again.
Science, community science.
Community science. There we go. You're up now.
Okay. Greetings, everyone. Thank you all for being here tonight. And I just want to say, first off, I'm so honored to be able to speak tonight in honor of Black Thursday. And yeah, I'll just go ahead and read a little snippet I wrote about Black Thursday. To be a Black student leader means advocating for all Black students and serving the Black community by providing resources and opportunities for the advancement of Black students. To be a Black student leader means starting to dismantle the systematic racial barriers that for generations have blocked the educational, social, and economic progress of Black students. To be a Black student leader means upholding and honoring the traditions of Black students on campus that generations before us have fought for. This is exactly what Black Thursday signifies. In 1971, seven courageous students fought for the demands of Black students on campus to create an environment that welcomes and supports Black students and is conducive to learning. We gather today to commemorate their wonderful legacy. We will never forget the impact of Black Thursday. I encourage you all to continue to advocate for Black students and for your community on campus and the surrounding community as well, because we are nothing without others, and we must always stand in unity to continue to push forward and fight these systematic barriers that we still see progress today. Even though we have made progress, the work is not done. I encourage you all to continue to immerse yourself in the community and to gather with faculty, staff, with other students, and fight for the demands of Black students now and for generations to come, as we are starting our own legacy now. And that is all I have to say. Thank you all again for coming out tonight and having me speak. It is such an honor.
Thank you, Smita, for those words. And as we said, you know, we celebrate Dr. King. We don't want no sanitized Black Thursday, right? We know There's more Black faculty, there's more Black students. We get that, right? But we also know, like the students saying, there's work to be done, whether it's UF or the country at whole, or even the globe. So we want to ensure that when we have commemorations, they're not sanitized, right? Like we try to do with Dr. King, or you can make movies about Black Panthers now and kind of still flip the dial, right? So we always have to be mindful. That's why history is so important, right? History is what you want to hear and what you don't want to hear at the same time. So I'm going to stop there and I'm going to introduce our keynote speaker. We have Dr. Betty J. Stewart-Fullwood, was a program director and senior lecturer in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences at the University of Florida. She served as interim director of OASIS from fall 2007 to February 2010. She is a native Gainesvillian who graduated from Lincoln High School, attended Bethune-Cookman College in Daytona Beach, Florida, and received a Bachelor's of Art degree in psychology, Master's of Arts in Social Psychology, and a PhD in Counselor Education, all from the University of Florida. She was an undergraduate student at the University of Florida during 1971, who participated in Black Thursday protests and withdrew along with other African-American and white students when demands for better conditions were not met. She was employed in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences from August 1974 until February 2010, where she directed the Student Enrichment Services Program and served as interim director of OASIS. The program assists undergraduate minority students in making a smooth transition from high school to college. She has served as the advisor to the Black Student Union for 33 years. She also has served in the past as advisor to University of Florida Gospel Choir and the National Council of Negro Women. Now her bio is so long, it's almost been as long as her talk. I'm gonna stop there. And without further ado, well, let's please welcome Dr. Betty J. Stewart-Fullwood.
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here to discuss and to celebrate 50 years prior to after Black Thursday. It doesn't seem like it's been that long. I must have been like 6 years old when I was here on campus, because that would make me like 56 right now. But we know that it is very historical, and that I'm glad that we're able to do it. I'm going to give a little bit of background. I have a slide presentation that I'll share with you in a minute, and that will pretty much explain my presentation. But I'll just do the introduction. The book that I wrote along with Kevin McCarthy, which is African Americans at the University of Florida, came about pretty much after 1997 homecoming. For 1997, the theme for homecoming had something to do with looking at greats. And so what I did was I went into the archives and looked at African American greats to the University of Florida. And I pretty much made a list, a little brochure that I had passed out at IBC during homecoming parade. And there were a lot of people in there. It was African-American firsts. And I didn't have in there Don Gaffney, who was the first Black quarterback for UF. And he called me in my office from Jacksonville. And he said, how could you do a book of firsts? I mean, a list of firsts and not have my name on there. And I said, I'm so sorry, I didn't put your name in there. And so then that made me start to go back and start looking at other things. So I just compiled this list of firsts for African Americans on the University of Florida campus. And then when the university was planning for the sesquicentennial, the 150th anniversary for 2003, I decided I would go even a little further with that. And so Kevin McCarthy approached me about writing a book about African American history, since I had pretty much all the history that from 1970 on from the university, because I had been collecting articles, and I was BSU advisor, and I had all kinds of I would say antiques now, put all kinds of brochures and about all the different events that had happened. So that's how the book came about. Black Thursday is just one of the major events that we look back on. When I was growing up at in the city of Gainesville here, and I'm going to share screen now. And I'm going to view it. Let me see, slideshow presentation. Okay. When I was growing up at the in the city of Gainesville, I was a part of Lincoln High School. Lincoln High School was, I won't say predominantly Black, it was a Black high school here in the city. And we participated in the Gator Homecoming Parade every year, our band did. And we also participated in Gator Growl. So people ask, well, when did you become a Gator? Well, I was a Gator from seventh grade on up when I participated in homecoming parades at University of Florida and also at Gator Growl. So this person here is me with my clarinet in homecoming, October 27th, 1967. When I graduated from Lincoln in 68, I went to Bethune-Cookman College. And I went to Bethune-Cookman for a year and a half. And after a year and a half, I transferred back to the University of Florida. But having come back to the University of Florida was also a second time for me, because as a junior in high school, I was a part of a pilot program that was from a grant that allowed about 20 African-American students from Lincoln High School to come on campus and to get to know campus by being assigned different offices. And we worked during that summer. I was assigned the Office of Division of Sponsored Research with Patricia Rambo was my boss. And so I was on campus that whole summer before my senior year. So I got to know about different parts of campus, different offices, and I had to run errands back and forth. I was a student assistant pretty much. And so when I came back in the spring of 1970, I was pretty much familiar with campus. I stayed at home, so I would come to class and go to work, and then I would go home. So I was pretty familiar with the campus layout. A year later, 1971, is when all of the beginnings of Black Thursday happened. When I transferred back here, everything I thought was like, I guess we would say peachy cream. But I had been through an all Black experience in high school, and Bethune-Cookman University now was an all Black institution at that time as well. And I was used to excelling. I was used to getting along with everyone, and I didn't have any problems. I didn't have any problems on campus as a student assistant either. But during the spring of 1971, problems started to arise, and there were concerns for Black students here that we needed to do more to make sure that other Black students would follow us and that we would have more Black faculty and staff. So at that time, the BSU officers are listed here, moving this over so I can see it. Wesley Dean, Homer Hartage, Deborah David, and Atenji Kamu. Next. Okay, so demands that went out were, and I'm sure everyone's seen this before, commitment on the part of the university to recruit and admit 500 Black students, have a quota of 2,800 freshmen, and a continuance of the critical year freshman program. Establishment of a Department of Minority Affairs under the direction of a full vice president, the immediate elevation of Mr. Roy Mitchell to this vice presidency. Hire a Black administrator in academic affairs with the advice and recommendation of Department of Minority Affairs to coordinate and recruitment of Black faculty. The hiring of Black assistant manager and personnel, the intensification of recruitment and hiring of Black faculty so as to reflect the ratio of Black students admitted on the proposal number one, the fair and equal treatment of our Black brothers and sisters who are employed by the university. And this was an addendum to the bottom of those demands that most people don't don't see when they see the demands. It says, thus far, even though we have pleaded, begged, and worked diligently with the administration, our cries have been ignored. This university has consistently denied us these basic needs we deem necessary. We are the voice of the Black student, the Black work, and the entire Black community, and for our full participation as students, employees, and citizens of this state, these needs must be met. Some of the critical players at that time were Mr. Roy Mitchell, who was the coordinator for UF Minority Affairs, Kip Smith, who was Student Government Secretary for Minority Affairs, and David Freeman, who was BSU Deputy Minister for Information. Now, just to give you a little background on what happened, was that initially Black students had listed these demands to President O'Connell. They've been doing this for about 18 months. And he had not acted on them. He had not responded anyway to what they had proposed. So a group of students went to O'Connell's office in an attempt to see him and talk to him about it. And they were asked to leave. They left. Then a second group went. They were asked to leave. They left. And then third group that was more vocal and more folk decided that they would come and sit in O'Connell's office. And he said if they didn't leave, he would have them arrested. So true to his form, he allowed them to be arrested. So the ultimatum to the demands was, I'll show you what it was here, yes. There was an ultimatum that was issued. It said that in full amnesty was not granted to all persons arrested Thursday, April 15, 1971, if there is no acceptable commitment to resolve the proposals presented on April 15th, then we, the Black students, will withdraw from the University of Florida Monday, April 26, 1971. So that was actually the date of withdrawal. At that time, there were other players in the game as well, Mr. Neil Butler, who was the mayor of Gainesville as well as a nursing graduate student. And he had said that he would withdraw along with the students if they withdrew, even though he was working on his master's in nursing. There was also a Jet magazine article. And back then Jet was, I guess, equivalent to Twitter, I guess you would say. But it came on a weekly basis and it was a little small magazine, but it gave you all the information of what was going on with Blacks throughout the United States. So the UF made Jet magazine, and that was with Ronald Jackson, Earl Wilcox, and Joseph McLeod. And what had happened was they were arrested for forcing whites to be janitors. But what really happened was that the white students in the dorms were making messes in the hallways and in the living spaces and expecting the Black custodial staff to clean up their mess, not just to clean up the dorm, but to clean up their mess. And so Joe McLeod, Ronald, and Earl decided they were gonna make them clean it up, that they weren't gonna allow Black custodians to clean up their mess. So they're accused of, I think, pulling a gun on them or whatever, but that was one of the highlights of that era as well. So the withdrawal began, and this is an article from April 29, 1971. The total number of withdrawals at that time was 117. There were a lot of demonstrations. There was a lot going on, as I said before. Lincoln High School had been closed down after we graduated. Our class that graduated in 68, class that was there for 69, they went home for Christmas break and the building was locked so that when they returned from Christmas break, they had to attend Gainesville High School or whatever the high schools that were there. They were not given any kind of warning or anything. They just closed it down. So there were a lot of protests and there were a lot of things going on while I was at Bethune-Cookman that year after I graduated. There was a lot of protests going on because of the closing down of Lincoln High School, which happened pretty much the same way in all of the cities in the state of Florida and elsewhere. When integration began, it was actually closing down of Black, historically Black high schools. And Lincoln High School was a center, pretty much, of Black, of Blackness, I would say, in Gainesville. We had the band, which was top-notch, won all kinds of awards. We had the chorus, which was top-notch. We had the Fight and Terrier football team. We had basketball team. We had a swimming pool there near the campus. We were the top-notch of everything. And so when you closed that down, there was a lot of dissent within the Black community, from the older Blacks as well as the younger Blacks. So I know that the students that graduated in 69, I think they graduated from Lincoln High, from Gainesville High School and other schools, but they were allowed to have their diploma say Lincoln High School. So there was a lot of stuff going on. And of course there was the Vietnam War going on. There was a lot of dissension with that. There was a lot of the civil rights stuff going on. So there was a lot going on. So this protest may have seemed like it was out of the blue, but it wasn't, because it was a culmination of a lot of stuff that was going on in the city, the state, and the United States as well. This is another one, a picture of the withdrawal from UF. And this, I like to show this one, Shelton. Shelton, of course, is 52 years old now, and he works sometimes in the poll system when we're doing elections. And I showed him this picture, and so I had to send it to him so he could have it on his phone. But this is Shelton McPherson. He's a son of one of my high school and band mates from Lincoln, who was also here at the University of Florida. Janice chose not to withdraw after talking over with her father. She chose not to withdraw. And she went on to receive her degrees from the University of Florida as well. Okay, I'm trying to find my cursor. Here we go. Okay, that's just a copy of my withdrawal notice. You wonder, why did I keep all this? I don't know. I'm a pack rat. I'm a junk rat. I don't know. I actually have a scrapbook, and I can't show it on the view that we have now, but I have a scrapbook with all these old articles in it, and I don't know why I decided to collect them, to keep them, to whatever. I hated history when I was in high school, but I decided that I needed to have a record of what happened back in 1971. So that's my withdrawal notice. Everything was done by hand. This was in the basement of Tiger Hall. And you had to do everything by hand and give it, and then you'd wait to get a letter back that was typed on a typewriter and sent back to you. So on the date, I think it says 223, I can't remember. And my reason for withdrawal, I had racial discrimination. I was like bold, like, you know, telling it like it is. This is a letter that I received back saying that, you know, they received my letter of withdrawal. April 27th, 1971, Winnie Smallwood was the supervisor for records and registration at that time. So that's my letter that they sent. Okay, and I'm going forward now. Okay, so we went through the whole process of withdrawing. I know that some people decided not to withdraw. Some people decided to withdraw. Some people decided to withdraw and not come back. Some people decided to withdraw and come back. I was one of the ones who decided to come back. I know that at the time, it was not a decision that I had to talk over with my parents. I don't remember a conversation about don't withdraw or withdraw, because as I said, there were a lot of parents that were backing students in the community because of what was happening with Lincoln and what was happening throughout the United States. So there was, you know, there may have been some who said, you know, you need to stay. And there were some who said that you know, should withdraw. And by the way, I'm over here at the Institute of Black Culture because I did a presentation there at 5:30. So if you hear a lot of noise, I don't think people know that I'm in this room. So hopefully the background isn't coming through over here. So once we withdrew, I decided to come back. And a lot of the demands that we had asked for were met. The Institute of Black Culture, of course, was established after the end of that year. We had Black faculty and staff that came in. I'm going to show you some pictures of this and before. But this picture here is Dr. William Simmons. And Mr. Virgil Hawkins. I'm not sure who the lady is beside him, but everyone should know who Virgil Hawkins is. He's the person that applied for admission to the University of Florida Law School many, many times and was denied. And the only reason that others were admitted was because he filed a lawsuit, and the lawsuit pretty much said that he couldn't be admitted, but it would open the door for others to be admitted. So he sacrificed his tenure at University of Florida for others. And that's how others came. So he was here on campus. I think it was back in 1985 that he came on campus for either Black History Month or Martin Luther King Day. And Bill Simmons was one of the directors of the Institute of Black Culture. This is just a letter of acknowledgement for Black faculty and staff at the time. There was another incident on campus, which was called BAM, and it was pretty much a student government trying to tell BSU how they could use their funds for Black History Month and was holding back on their funds. So the Black faculty and staff wrote a letter in support of the Black students. This is a picture of some of the first Black faculty and staff that came to the University of Florida, Dr. Carlton Davis, Ms. Dr. Pauline Lawrence, who happens to be married to Dr. Carlton Davis, and Dr. Ronald Foreman. This is Mr. George Stark, along with myself and Mr. George Allen, Esquire. George Stark was the first one to be admitted into law school. And George Allen was the first one to graduate from law school. Back in 2006, the Black Student Union did a tribute to Black Thursday. And this is the front of the t-shirt. I started to bring the t-shirt, but this is the front of the t-shirt, and then this is the back of the t-shirt. And it pretty much says, on Thursday, April 15, 1971, of 123 students from the University of Florida changed the face of history in response to racial tensions inflicted by the university administration. These courageous students withdrew from the University of in a united display of their belief in equity for all students. Black History Month 2006 celebrates the 35th anniversary of Black Thursday and the changes influenced by the students who were brave enough to stand for their beliefs. And this is this is the enactment of Black Thursday that was done on that day in 2006. This is Joseph McLeod. He was one of the ones that was in the Jet article. And students were pretty much coming up to sign petitions for the BSU demands. And this is another picture with Joseph McLeod. This is old meeting new. This is Lydia Washington, who was involved with student government and BSU while she was here at the university. And she's shaking hands with Joseph McLeod. These are some of the other persons that came before us. Dr. Reuben Earl Bigotry was one of the first two African-American students at the University College of Medicine. And I had a chance to take a picture with him back in 2019, when the Samuel Proctor Oral Program did a presentation. And he came in. It was my first time ever meeting him, and he's in my book, but it's first time ever meeting him. Also, Honorable Stephen Nickel, who was the first American to receive a UF undergraduate degree. This was at that same occasion, I believe. And also his wife, Evelyn Nickel, who was the first African-American to receive a UF nursing degree. And this is Mr. Samuel Taylor, who was also a graduate from Lincoln High School and the first African-American student government vice president and student government president. As I thought about this presentation, I thought about African-Americans that had gone on before even me. And so I thought about an African-American, I said honor roll, or I guess it would be a Hall of Fame, maybe. Maybe we can do a Black American Hall of Fame. And I thought about all these people that had gone on before me, S.D. McGill, who had applied to take an extension course at the university back in 1920 and was referred to FAMU. The 85 Black students who had applied and were denied admission from 1945 to 1958. Mr. Virgil Hawkins, who withdrew his application for UF in exchange for a court-ordered desegregation. Mr. George Stark, Jr., the first Black law student. Ms. Daphne Duvall Williams, who I knew from Lincoln, but had also taken courses here as a Black student. Mr. George Allen, Willie George Allen, Esquire, who was the first Black law student graduate. And then the first Black undergraduates, Alice Marie Davis, Jesse Dean, Rose Green, Jacinia Williams, Oliver Gordon, Stephen Mickle, John Reddick, Black Thursday key figures, Mr. Roy Mitchell, Mr. Neil Butler, the 72 students that were arrested, which included also two white males, the 123 students who began the withdrawal process from UF, Kip Smith, Samuel Taylor, Service Employees Union, they supported us. They wrote letters of support as well. Dr. David Horn, Willie Holden, Ed Dawkins, Father Michael Gannon, Clarence Martin, David Chandler, Steve Ufelder, and Don Middlebrooks were presidents of student government. First Black faculty and staff, Dr. Thomas A. Wright, Dr. Ron Foreman, Dr. Elwar Choi, who resigned during Black Thursday protest, Professor Betty Ingram, Dr. Carlton Davis, Dr. Elwin Adams, Billy Avery. And I already have, I've already talked about Dr. Reuben Earl Bigotry, but also Dr. Henry Earl Cotman was also the first African-Americans to graduate from med school. And LaVon Wright, I thought that was very, necessary to put in because that was the first financial aid counselor. And you know that if you can't get financial aid, you're not going to be able to make it at UF. So this was the first time that an African-American had a say-so in funds for students. Okay. Okay. That's all of that presentation. And I don't know how long I was supposed to go, but if there are any other questions, I can answer them as needed.
Well, thank you for that presentation. You can put questions in the chat, and I have a first one to start it off. So obviously, like you said, Jet Magazine was our BET, was the news. When stuff started in San Francisco State, how long did it take before you found out? The next week, the next year? How were you communicating with other campuses, or how did that work?
I think it was pretty much word of mouth. There may have been telephones. I don't know. been telephone conversations, but if we didn't get it from Jet or from Ebony Magazine, we didn't get it.
Gotcha.
And it was probably late when we got it.
Yeah, right. Okay. There's a question in the chat. With the exception of from Dr. Sharon Austin, with the exception of Virgil Hawkins and Stephen Mickle, why don't we have memorials buildings honoring any of these people?
I think, you know, if you really want to know, it's probably all about the money. It's all about the money. People buy buildings. Mm. People buy places on campus. And I don't think that we've put forth those kinds of funds. Mm.
Anybody, any other questions? Oh, here's one. What advice do you have for students today in terms of keeping UF accountable?
I think that I'm sitting here in the IBC, but I'm looking out at these police out here. I'm wondering why the police out here in the hallway. Okay, so hopefully there's nothing going on. There's just, maybe they're visiting the IBC. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, you have to hold UF accountable for everything that's going on. I mean, knowing the history, first of all, you have to know the history, and then also not to allow the history to be repeated. There are a lot of different things. I know when I retired in 2010 from UF, there were some things that were happening on campus with Black students and I'm sure Black faculty as well, but Black students, there were a lot of things, incidents that were happening, just like there are a lot of shootings and murders of Blacks now. There was a lot of different little crazy kind of things happening on campus. And I think that at that time, students did stand up and protest, and they did handle it well. But I think that you can't allow something to go unchallenged. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You also think, you don't have to not think in terms of, I know I'm back then, it was very prestigious to get into the University of Florida. And, you know, why would you turn that down? Why would you even think about leaving? Because, you know, you had so much to lose, but not going there. But there were other schools, and we decided to come here, and we decided to go elsewhere. But that was where we decided to come. Policeman's waving at me. Okay, I guess everything's okay. And so, you know, I think that you have to be willing to call a bluff if someone says, well, you're not going anywhere, because where else are you going to go? And we have this, or we have that, or we're doing this for you. I think that you have to stand up for principle. And everybody says, well, why did you withdraw? And I said, it was like the movie said, it was just the principle of the whole thing. Mm-hmm. It was just the principle of it that, you know, you said we were going to withdraw, so we're going to withdraw, and that's it, you know?
Ms. Richardson, you had your hand up.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Beta Stewart-Fullwood, for that wonderful presentation. I was nine and when this back in 1971.
Wow.
What I want to ask is about the greater Gainesville community, the Black community around Gainesville, Alachua County. How involved were they, or how important were they, or how involved were they to what was going on, your movement, what was going on campus during that time? And what would you have any suggestions about the community and Black students and the community at large uniting now or getting more involved or that kind of thing?
Yeah, I think that the Black community was very involved. And as I said before, I'm a native Gainesvillian, so I pretty much know the town and the gown aspects of Gainesville. And the NAACP was very active. Reverend Thomas A. Wright, who was the pastor of Mount Carmel Baptist Church, and who later began teaching some classes here on campus, he was very vocal. He was also one of the spokespersons for groups in St. Augustine. He was from St. Augustine and moved here. And so he was very vocal. The NAACP, Mr. Charles Chestnut, all of the movers and shakers for the city of Gainesville, especially the pastors of the different churches. That was the way that we did it back then. The pastors of the churches were involved, the congregations were involved, and I think, because I'm from Gainesville, I think that the students that were from Gainesville knew that Blacks in the city of Gainesville had their backs. I know Geraldine Williams was on a panel discussion earlier this week with me, and she was here in 1960s. And she said that pretty much she could go down on Fifth Avenue to Fletcher's, to Mama Lowe's, to whatever the establishments were there and she could dance, she could have fun and know that she was in a safe environment, that comfortable to her. And so I think that's the way that most Blacks felt, that once they got into the, and I'm not going to say the hood, but in the neighborhood, that they felt comfortable going there. And they were a part of the community as much as they could be.
Any other questions? If you have a question, put it in the chat.
And as far as the, I just wanted to say a few things too about the custodial staff and the grounds staff here. They knew that the struggle was real. They knew what was going on and they knew, we knew what they had to go through. That was why Joe and those did what they did in the dormitories. That's how I think that kind of helped us to be melted together, because they knew what the struggle was with the students and they, we knew what the struggle was with them in the on the grounds or working in the hallways. So we always knew that, you know, anything went down, we knew that, you know, they would show us the way to get out of it. Mm-hmm. They would be our underground tunnel.
And right, like you said, that's why we say about, oh, here we go. What is one lesson you want students to take away after learning the history of Black Thursday?
I think united, you can do anything. And the divisiveness that I think came about later on at the university was not what we fought for in 1971. Mm-hmm. So I think that once they're united, and there are, people have the opportunity to become members of different organizations and to branch out, which is not a problem, and it was not a problem in 71. But I related on some webinar, I can't remember now, a webinar about the fact that when I came on campus, when I transferred back, and I was going back and forth on campus to different buildings for my job as a student assistant in sponsored research or going to classes. And having come from an all-Black high school, gone to an all-Black college, Bethune-Cookman, and coming here on campus, you know, Black people were few and far in between. And so when you would see someone approaching, you know, you're getting yourself all together, figured out, you know, you're going to say hi, you're going to say hello, you're going to say what's up, are you going to, you know, up the head, are you going to down the head, or how are you going to approach this person and speak? You're getting yourself all ready to speak. And you walk into a person, and as soon as you get close to them, they turn and look another way. That to me was like, are you kidding me? That would not have happened on the Bethune-Cookman College campus. You know, you didn't not speak to others. That was just common courtesy. You didn't not acknowledge the presence of someone else in your space. And so that was one of the things that, you know, when I became BSU advisor, that I said, you know, what makes you so that you can't speak to someone coming, you know, people are looking to make friends and see people. And that if you saw, at this time was a lot of stuff going on between fraternities and sororities. Mm-hmm. And I said, if you saw a young man hanging from a tree, are you going to go up and look to see whether or not he has a Q engraved on his arm, a Kappa, or a Phi Beta Sigma insignia? You know, it's going to be a Black student. Mm-hmm. And that's how they see us, and that's how we should see ourselves, as a unit and not divisive.
Okay, Valeria Thomas has their hand up. I don't see the question. I guess they're gonna ask it. Valeria Thomas? Oh, okay, I see that. You go ahead and ask your question.
She's muted.
Oh, she's muted. Ms. Thomas, until she unmutes, wait, is she gonna do it? I'll put it in the chat, okay. Not yet, all right. Huh, all right, so let me get another question. I think there's been a lot of new views in the news about Silicon Valley and the challenge of hiring African-American students. So explain, in other words, when Black students got on campus, in 69, 70, right? How do you articulate, when we talk about a white space or cultural space, you know, I make this argument that, you know, if you go to Silicon Valley, you know, you have a deep sound of voice, you come up with Morehouse and Black cultural aesthetic stuff, you're gonna struggle in Silicon Valley. When you come to UF, the only white institution, you're bringing Black cultural stuff, Lincoln High School, you repping the bands. Explain, how is that? I mean, that's when we talk about that culture space, every institution have a culture. I went to Morehouse, you know the culture, HBCU, hop shows, that's just standard. When you come to PWIs, how important is that cultural piece? You know, I think oftentimes white institutions think because you have a few Black people on the space, but the culture, the core, how do you explain at 68, 69, you have 100 Black students, 200, when you walk to a white space, explain that transition. You know, I think people underestimate what does that mean when your culture, sweet potato pie, Baptist churches, is just like, what? And, you know, explain that. How does that work in 69, 70?
Well, there wasn't really an opportunity for me to explain that. I mean, I didn't stay in the residence halls.
Okay.
So I came, I did my classes. I went to my student assistant job, and that was pretty much it. So I didn't, for lack of a better term, have to deal with what happened afterwards, because I still went to the same church that I went to before I left. I had the same community. A lot of my classmates had stayed here and gone to Santa Fe Community College, and it just pretty much opened up here in Gainesville. Some of them were here on campus as well. So I had my own clique or my own group of people that I dealt with. So it didn't matter to me one way or the other what they felt or thought about what my ethnicity was or whatever, because they were not a part of mine. I mean, I remember when I was even going into middle school. Well, it wasn't middle school then, it was elementary school, and then it was high school. And I remember the first time that, I'm trying to think, when was the first time? I had no idea, to tell you the truth. I had no idea where white students went to school, if they went to school. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I got on the bus, my elementary school was within walking distance, so it was like two blocks. So I went to my elementary school, and then I was bused over to Lincoln, I think. We caught the bus for Lincoln. But in the afternoons, once I got at Lincoln, we had band, and we had band practice. And so we would go to school all day, and then we would walk home from Lincoln over towards Duval Elementary, which I don't know how many miles it is, and I don't know how we did it. But after marching band practice, we would walk over back home. And so I didn't really encounter white students coming up. And I was like, they must be some dumb people, because they don't go to school at all. We don't ever see them anywhere. And I guess the buses weren't even passing each other then. So I didn't really have a feel for what other people did.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions? Couple more questions, anybody else? 50th anniversary. And again, well, definitely I appreciate the names you put there. And again, I'm new to UF, you know, so I kept hearing Black Thursday, because obviously I knew the master narrative, San Francisco State, Yale, Cornell, you know, those make the news and all that. But obviously coming here to last, and with your presentation, I've seen a couple of times, really making Black Thursday a central part of what we do here and recognizing the work, the sacrifice that you've done and many of your peers, and we appreciate it. And that's the beauty about golden anniversaries, right? We can actually see and talk. You see it, but as we all said, we still have a ways to go. So I think we'll always keep that in your mind, and obviously our students doing great work. So I think on that end, we will end this golden celebration. And like I said, I wrote a piece, hopefully it won't take 50 years. Hopefully this will shrink it down to 5 for the next steps and nothing, right? We'll be a little faster, quicker, more efficient. But definitely always thank you to the elders, the work that you do. I want to thank everybody that participated, everybody that showed up. I know it's late in the semester, we got finals. I want to thank my producer, Ms. Yesenia Jarrett. This whole Zoom thing, you need like a DJ now. She handled all the Zoom, right? And I'd like to thank her and everybody that showed up. And again, thank you, Dr. Stewart-Fullwood, for your presentation. And I think everybody should have a good evening. I was going to play an out song. The number one song in May of 1971 was, we're going to go out on this song. You see, you got it for me?